So welcome everyone. This will be the last webinar of the Hidden ITN this season. So now we are entering the summer period with lots of conferences, unfortunately, most of them online still. And it is a pleasure and we have to thank him to have Gregorio today, Gregorio Ordoiza. He's from the IFT and the Department of Theoretical Physics in Madrid, and since relatively recently, finally a permanent member. And he was kind enough to prepare this talk upon request, given the interest now with the recent results on the muon G-2. To prepare this talk on the hadronic uncertainties, the hadronic contributions to the muon G-2, since these dominate the uncertainty and are critical to understand the result. And since it is a topic in which he has lots of experience, he was kind enough to prepare this on relatively short notice. So thank you, Gregorio, and whenever you want.
Okay. Thanks very much, Enrique, for the invitation to present this work. So indeed, I will focus the discussion in the hadronic contributions, because this is the central part of the problem in consolidating currently the standard model value for the muon G-2. So the overall motivation for this is, of course, the fact that one needs additional features with respect to the standard model related, for instance, to the fact that the matter is dominating over antimatter in the universe and would need additional sources of CP violation, the existence of dark matter. And also within the standard model, we don't fully understand many features, for instance, the large number of parameters that are present in the flavor sector associated to masses and Nixon parameters. So in order to go beyond the standard model, one approach is to do direct searches. That implies looking for new particles and exploring larger energies of new physics, lambda and p, through high energy collisions in current colliders such as the LHC or in future colliders. And by increasing the luminosity, one can also explore smaller couplings, or one can also look directly for dark matter through direct detection. Another avenue is to go through this hunt of new physics through indirect searches. So that typically goes into lower energies with respect to this energy frontier of colliders. And the idea here is to do an accurate as possible comparison between the standard model predictions of some quantities and the experimental measurements. So one can consider, for instance, very precisely known quantities in the standard model, and this is the example of the muon G-2. One could also consider rare or even forbidden processes, and by comparing the standard model value to the experiment in which the relative contribution from new physics is high, one could have signals of these new physics. So one can consider both flavor changing, flavor violating processes and flavor conserving processes. In the case of flavor violation processes, there are many experimental efforts going on. They go on under the names of experiments such as BEL2, LHCb, and so on. And in the flavor conserving processes, class of quantities of interest are the muon G-2, EDMs. And in addition to these direct studies through these experiments, one could also do global fits of the standard model in the flavor sector, for instance, in the CKM sector, through unitarity triangle analysis and check consistency of various channels in the CKM picture. In the case of the muon G-2, there is a very close relation of this quantity to the running of the electromagnetic coupling, the running of QED, which is one of the ingredients in the electric precision tests. So through these global tests of the electric sector, one can also have a handle on both collider physics and these low energy physics associated to the mu and g minus two, the running of the QD coupling and other quantities. So the problem here is precision, of course. One requires a very good control of the standard model prediction. And in principle, this implies going deep into understanding QED weak and QCD interactions in order to control fully the standard model prediction. And of course, since we want precision in the mu and g minus two, this implies facing new challenges. So let me concentrate on that first. So the magnetic moment of a charged lepton mu here is related to its spin through this equation, where GL is the geomagnetic ratio. It's a dimensionless quantity. And the other quantities are either fundamental constants or fundamental parameters of the standard model. So the anomalous magnetic moment of the lepton in the case of the muon, for instance, is defined as the relative difference with respect to two of this geomagnetic ratio G mu. In the Dirac theory, which is given by this diagram, simply interaction of the lepton with a photon, G is equal to two, and therefore the anomalous magnetic moment is zero. And through virtual effects, the first of which was computed by Schringer in 1948 with the exchange of a photon, the anomalous magnetic moment deviates from zero and takes a value in the case of the first one, the one loop correction computed by Schringer, equals to alpha over two pi. So this is a one per mil effect. And in the standard model, there will also be contributions from the weak interaction and from QCD. So these are the diagrams, examples of diagrams that contribute at leading order in each of these interactions. So in the weak interaction, there will be a Z exchange. And in the case of QCD, there would be a quark anti-quark loop attached through photons to the leptons. Okay, so this is the so-called leading order hadronic vacuum polarization diagram, and it will be most of the topic of this seminar today. So the virtuality, the Q squared value of the photon can be arbitrary, can take any value from small to infinite, and therefore the momentum that flows in the diagram here in the quark anti-quark loop can be small. And this is of course controlled by non-perturbative physics associated to QCD. So there are two ways to compute the contribution of this diagram. One is through dispersion relations associated with experimental data of E plus and minus into hadrons. And the other is through lattice gauge theory methods. And I will discuss more in detail this. So this process here is a chirality flipping process. The chirality of the two leptons is flipped under this process. And in the context of new physics, one expects the new physics contributions to go like the ratio of the lepton mass squared over the scale of new physics squared. So for the case of the electron, AE, so the G minus two of the electron is less sensitive to new physics by a factor 400 squared, the ratio of 200 squared, the ratio of the mass of the lepton to the mass of the muon to the mass of the electron. One expects, of course, that for the case of the tau, these contributions will be even larger with respect to the muon. But the problem there is that the tau lifetime is so short that one cannot do very accurate experiments of the tau g minus two. On the other hand, for the muon, one can do accurate experiments. These are based on energetic muons that enter a storage ring, which have a vertical magnetic field that makes them turn around the storage ring. And they also make the linearly polarized muons precess with respect to the momentum. And by the measurement of this precession frequency, one can directly extract a mu once we know also the magnetic field to very high accuracy. So this has been behind a large series of experiments started at CERN, then went to BNL 20 years ago. And the excitement now is that there is a new experiment that 2 months ago published the first results. So this is the status of this comparison of the experimental results to the standard model. Here you see the BNL result. This is a new measurement that appeared two months ago from the Fermilab experiment. they are in agreement, which is a very important check of the technology used in the experiment. And therefore one can combine them, and this is the experimental combination of the two results. And this is the standard model as obtained from the muon G-T2 theory initiative white paper that appeared in 2020. So this standard model prediction for uses for the hadronic vacuum polarization, the dispersive approach and not the lattice approach. Okay, so I will comment more on that, of course, during the talk. So if you look at the experimental result of ABU, well, you see that it's very precise. It's a 0.46 part per million result. So since we're interested in comparison between theory and experiment, you can basically concentrate only in the blue numbers. The rest of the digits here are the same, and therefore you can only concentrate on the blue part. All the numbers that I will give in the talk are in units of 10 to the minus 10. Okay, so maybe it's good to keep in mind that in these units, the current average of experimental results has an error of 4. Okay, so this sets a scale of the size of the errors. The standard model result from the white paper is also with an error of 4. Okay, and the difference between the two is 25 in these units with an error of 6. And this is what leads to this 4.2 sigma. Okay, so on the experimental side, there is already a very substantial progress with respect to BNL done for the Fermi Lab experiment, because the systematic error is 2 times smaller than the BNL already now. Okay, their target is to reduce this 0.16 part per million to 0.1. So they are already quite close to their target. On the statistical side, their target is to reduce this by a factor of 4 in such a way that this error here, 4.1, will at the end of the Fermilab experiment in maybe 4 years from now, will have an error of 1.5. Okay, so that is the target, 1.5 in 10 to the minus 10. Okay, so on the theory side, this 0.37 part per million error is coming mainly from 0.34 part per million coming from lowest order hadronic vacuum polarization. So most of the error here is coming from this hadronic vacuum polarization contribution. On the same day that Fermilab presented the result, a lattice paper from the Budapest Marseille Wuppertal collaboration was published. This paper appeared more than a year ago as a preprint, but was published on the same day as the Fermilab experiment presented the result. And the puzzling thing is that this result is basically compatible with the standard model. It differs by 1.5 sigma, and it's also basically compatible with the white paper result. It differs by 2 sigma with respect to the white paper result. So it basically sits in the middle of the two results. So this paper appeared before the white paper, but was published afterwards, and that is why it's not really reviewed and taken into account in the average of the white paper. Moreover, this is the first lattice result with 100% precision, and therefore it is expected to be cross-checked by various other lattice gauge theory computations that are being going on. There are about 6 other groups doing these computations right now. So the problem now is to understand what is going on with this difference between two determinations of the hadronic vacuum polarization contributions, which should agree. Okay, but let me note that at this level, the disagreement is not so big. It's at the level of 2 sigma. Okay, so let me now classify the contributions from the standard model. So there are 7 contributions that have to be summed in order to have the experiment, the theoretical prediction of AMU and compared to experiment. They are organized here in by the size of the uncertainties. So the first one is the largest uncertainty, the second is the second uncertainty, and so on. Okay, and as you can see, the uncertainty on the hadronic vacuum polarization, the 7 contributions here are drawn here through examples of diagrams that contribute. So this is the hadronic vacuum polarization contribution. Has an error of 4 in this 10 to the minus 10 units, which is basically dominating the full result from the standard model. The second contribution is the hadronic light by light. So this is a 4-point function, hadronic function connecting photons. Has an error of 1.7. So this is still relevant, but it's subdominant with respect to the first one. And the other contributions have errors which are much smaller than these first two, and that are actually smaller than the target experimental results. Okay, so most of the effort is concentrated on the two first contributions. The other are safe, thinking of the timeline of the comparison of the final result from the Fermilab experiment. So now I also add the central values, okay? So this error of 4 is actually the error of a quantity which is 693. So it's a per mil error, it's a 0.6% error, which is quite remarkable for something related to hadronic effects. So the precision on the hadronic vacuum polarization is the leading contribution to the total error, but it's very accurate in terms of something related to QCD strong interactions, okay? Hadronic effects in QCD. The second contribution is suppressed by 1 power of alpha. It's a 9, it's known to 20%. And there has been a lot of work in order to reduce this error to this level of 20%. If you think of the final error from the Fermilab experiment, which is 1.5 roughly, one deduces that one would need in the coming years a reduction by roughly a factor of 2 of this contribution to go basically to the 10% level error. Okay. Another interesting observation is that the difference between the experiment and the standard model value from the white paper is 25, and the weak contributions is 15. So if the standard model value consolidates around the white paper value, one would deduce that new physics should be larger, basically 2 times larger than the weak contribution. So it's a very large contribution from new physics if this is confirmed. The QED contribution is, of course, the largest contribution. It has a very small error, thanks to a remarkable progress in the computations that have allowed to compute the 5-loop contribution. Okay, so let me concentrate on the most problematic part associated to the large uncertainty. Okay, so this hadronic vacuum polarization lead-error contribution is related to this hadronic blob. So this is a 2-point function with vector currents of quarks, okay, associated to a quark anti-quark loop in the non-perturbative regime of QCD. So in order to compute this, you can use basic properties of the theory. You can use analyticity to rewrite these diagrams in terms of dispersion relations, which depends on the imaginary part of the diagram. And then you can use unitarity to apply the optical theorem to rewrite these in terms of the cross-section of E plus E minus into hadrons. Okay. In that way, you can write A mu HVP leading order in terms of the dispersive integral of the cross section of E plus E minus into hadrons. So basically, you have transformed the problem of not being able to compute non perturbative effects into summing over experimental data of this cross section. Okay. So this cross section involves an intermediate photon, so it's a vector current, so it will couple to the vector states that are present in the QCD spectrum. Most of the contribution is coming from the rho meson, okay, which decays predominantly with a high width of 150 MeV into 2 pi. Okay, so in this dispersive integral, this kernel Ks is known, is a known function. It is the same for the various flavors of quarks, and it enhances the contribution from low energy in such a way that the rho is the leading contribution here. So when you want to perform this integral, you have to combine more than 100 data sets from experimental data, and at high energies, one can use a perturbative QCD. Okay, so one thing to remember is that this will give you the standard model prediction for the hadronic vacuum polarization, which is based on experimental data. So of course, one basic assumption here is that there is no new physics present in this experimental data, okay? An alternative approach is to do a first principle computation of QCD on the lattice. So let me describe the data-driven approach. So you need this cross-section E plus E minus into hadrons. This can be done through direct scan. So basically you will change the center of mass energies of this electron positron pair and look in your detectors to the outgoing hadrons, including photons. Another possibility is to go one order higher in QED and allow for initial state radiation of photons in such a way that the energy taken by this photon is deducted here. And in that way, from a fixed energy incoming particles, you can vary the energy of the photon and scan in the square root of S variable. Okay, so this cross section has to include the emission, the final state emission of photons. And the reason is that if you think of this diagram, which is the basic diagram that you have to compute, it is very difficult to separate this photon from other photons that would go from the quark antiquark between them. Okay, so basically, by convention, this diagram, although it is higher order, it is included in the hadronic vacuum polarization leading order. And when you do the optical theorem and you cut this diagram, that implies that you need to consider the emission of photons in your experimental determination of the cross section. The superindex zero here implies that you need to consider the bare cross section, which implies that in this photon here, which in general you will have the full photon, the physical photon, you will need to subtract the contribution from the running of the QED couple. So how is this done? So this diagram, as I said, is the vector two-point function. Okay, so this is the hadronic vacuum polarization tensor. The conservation of electric charge allows to write this as a transfer projector, and this is the hadronic vacuum polarization function. Okay, and the currents J mu are the electromagnetic currents of quarks and have to be summed over all the flavors of quarks with the appropriate charge of each of the quarks. Okay, so the subtracted vacuum polarization function, so pi of q squared minus pi of zero, is related to the running of the QED coupling. So when you consider only the electromagnetic current of quarks, this will be the contribution of hadronic contribution to the running of the QED coupling. If you consider leptons, then you will have the contribution of leptons to the running of the QED coupling. And this can be parameterized in this way. So the dependence of q squared of the coupling is the value of q squared equals zero, so the fine structure constants, plus the contribution of the running, which is the sum of the various contributions of leptons and quarks. Okay, so the basic diagram that is behind the running of the QED coupling due to hadronic effects is the same diagram that you need for A mu. Okay, so you can also write it in terms of dispersion relation with the same cross section E plus E minus into hadrons. Okay, so now if you want to undress your cross section, you have to divide. If the full cross section is the bare cross section divided by the running of the QED coupling, but you have to note that in this running of the QED coupling, which is related to this delta alpha hat, there is also the cross section. So therefore, you have to solve an equation in which you have the cross section in the numerator and the denominator, and this is done iteratively. Okay, so this is the process that is needed in order to compute the bare cross section. There are systematic uncertainties associated to this undressing and this final state radiation. And they are not totally negligible, but they are taken into account in the computation of AMU. So the undressing is 0.2, the final state radiation is 0.7, and the total error is 4 in this 10 to the minus 10 units. Okay? Lattice can also help in computing this running of the QED couple. So now you have to integrate the cross section. You can build the R ratio, which is the cross section I mentioned before, divided by the E plus E minus into mu plus mu minus cross section, the point like one. And this is the data that you have to integrate in the small Q square region. So from zero to 2 GeV. This is the dominant contribution. As I said, the kernel suppresses higher energy. This is a logarithmic scale in the vertical axis. And you see that most of the contribution is coming from pi pi. Okay, so basically the raw channel. So if you look at the pi pi contribution, these are various experiments that are entering in the standard model prediction. And what you observe is that the most accurate experiments, which are Chloe and Babar, both use initial state radiation processes, differ at the 3 sigma level. Okay. And it's basically this difference here which dominates the error on the hadronic vacuum polarization contribution to a mu from the dispersal approach. So this difference here at the 3 sigma level. The expectation is that new data from new experiments will allow to solve this problem, which is currently not fully understood. Okay. So in order to introduce more theoretical constraint in this pi pi channel, one can also use the fact that it is related to the time-like pi and form factor. So the cross-section E plus C minus into pi plus pi minus can be written in terms of the pi and form factor. And the pi and form factor can be constrained from analyticity, unitarity, and crossing symmetry. So one can basically do a global fit of experimental data imposing these constraints from the theory side. Okay. So when you perform the sum over all the different channels, this is an example from one of the groups, KNT. What you observe is that for a mu, basically 75% of the contribution is coming from the region from threshold m pi to 0.9 GeV squared. And also basically 75% of the error is coming from that region. So it's basically dominated by that low energy region. In the case of the running of the QED coupling, the hadronic contribution, most of the contribution is coming from high energies, so from 11 GeV squared to infinity. And this has very little error because one can use perturbation theory there. Okay, the black pi, the black slice here in the pi is related to these radiative corrections that I mentioned before. Okay, so in the result from KNT19 for the value of FAMU, you observe that the total precision is 0.35%, so very accurate, and it is systematic dominated. Okay. So in the white paper, this result that I've just discussed, which is this, has been combined with another group, with the results of another group performing this integral of the R ratio data. And the combination was done through a merging procedure, not through a real average, in such a way that the white paper result doesn't have a smaller error than the two contributions, okay? The reason for doing that is that there was a very excruciated control channel by channel of the two groups. There were also these constraints from the time-like pi and form factor that I mentioned before. And the discrepancy between Chloe and Babar was treated in such a way that there is a conservative estimate in the error here. Okay. So this is the 4.2 sigma deviation that I've shown before. This point here shows the average of lattice results by the time of the white paper, okay? So as you see, it has a large uncertainty. And as I said, there are various groups trying to improve this. And this is the first lattice result with 100% precision from the BMW collaboration, which sits here, okay? So the white paper result leads to a 0.6% error. So now let me describe the lattice computation. So in the case of lattice QCD, one starts from the Lagrangian of QCD plus QED. F mu nu is the photon field strength tensor. G mu nu is the gluon one. A mu is a real valued quantity. B nu is a 3 by 3 Hermitian matrix. And what you do is you discretize the QCD and the QED Lagrangian in a lattice. Therefore, you introduce lattice spacing A, which is interpreted as an ultraviolet cutoff in a regularization of QCD. So basically, what you're doing here is you're regularizing QCD in a non-perturbative way on a lattice. Okay. On top of this ultraviolet cutoff, you also have an infrared cutoff associated to the volume of your lattice. So for instance, you can define that your quarks sit on the sides, your gluons sits on the links of your lattice. And therefore you can build this Wilson loop, one by one Wilson loop, which can be inserted into this expression for the gluon action of QCD. Okay, once you take the limit of lattice spacing to zero, you recover the continuum action, okay, for the gluons. The fact that you are using a discrete lattice and a finite volume implies that you have a finite number of degrees of freedom, and therefore you can fully perform the path integral numerically, okay? So in this case, since you're working in Euclidean space, the exponential of minus the action appears, and this can be interpreted as a statistical weight. And these integrals can be done through Monte Carlo techniques. So it's a first principles formulation in the sense that you can systematically improve the error. In this path integral here, the observable you will put in is this vector-vector two-point correlation function, if you're interested in AMU. Lattice QCD comes with statistical errors associated to the fact that you have this Monte Carlo integration. There is also an issue of signal-to-noise problem associated to this particular observable, because when you separate the two currents in distance in Euclidean time, then the noise grows exponentially fast, okay? So it's exponentially hard to have accurate results at large distances. And this is a complication because this diagram, as I showed before, is dominated at large distances, so at small energies, by the rho contribution, which decays into two pions. So it's basically dominated by the lightest particles in the QCD spectrum, okay? So this poses a challenge in various aspects. This poses a challenge in the finite volume effects, because you have these light particles flowing around your lattice. And it also will, as I will show in a minute, poses problems in the continuum limit extrapolation. So you have to sum over all the quark flavors. So that implies that you have to include in your simulations up, down, strange, charm, and bottom quarks, okay? If you aim at 0.6% error, which is the dispersive approach error, you also need to take into account the fact that up and down quarks have different masses and that you have electromagnetic corrections. Moreover, you need to know the lattice spacing of your lattice sufficiently accurately in Fermi. Okay, so all these are challenges for lattice computation. So there is a dispersive representation as well for AMU. So one can compute AMU from an integral of the subtracted vacuum polarization function with a kernel function which is known, which is an analytic function which is known, okay? So if you look at the integrand of this equation as a function of Q squared, what you observe is that this integrand is highly peaked at small values of Q squared. So in GV squared, the muon mass squared is 0.01, so it corresponds to this horizontal band here. So the peak of the integral is below the muon mass squared. On the lattice, the momenta are quantized by the volume. So if you want to be able to put a point in the region of the peak, that implies that you will need very large volumes associated to lattice strength of order 12 Fermi, okay? In practice, this integral can be split in regions, and in particular in the high Q squared region, one can use a perturbation theory. But it's, as you can see here, is dominated by the small Q squared region. In this representation, there is a problem associated to the small Q squared, because in the extraction of the vacuum polarization function here, you would need that at Q squared equals zero, the numerator is zero in order to have a proper cancellation between the numerator and the denominator. And through finite volume effects, the numerator is different from zero. And therefore, when you go to Q squared equals zero, this thing is not well behaved. And you have a large increase in the uncertainty at small Q squared. Okay, and this is critical because you need to subtract the pi of zero contribution here. So there is another representation which is safe in that respect because it allows you to compute directly the subtracted vacuum polarization. Okay, this is the so-called time momentum representation. So in this representation, the basic non-perturbative ingredient is this C of t, which is the Fourier transform in space of at zero momentum. So it's a zero momentum two-point correlation function, which is the basic object that nowadays lattice QCD groups are computing. Okay, so T here is the Euclidean time distance between the two electromagnetic cards. Okay, so now if you look at this integrand here, it has this shape. Okay, so it's peaked around one Fermi. And the problem is that at large distances, there is this exponential increase of the noise. Okay, so this shows you the huge progress that the BMW collaboration did between their earliest result in 2017 and the new result in reducing the error at large distances. And this has a huge impact on the accuracy they can reach overall. Okay, in such a way that currently their result is systematics dominated. They have managed to reduce significantly the error here in order to be systematics dominated. At some point, you need to go to infinity here. At some point, you can stop, say, around 4 Fermi, and use bounds coming from the fact that you know that the correlation function has to be positive and has to be smaller from the 2 pi contribution to estimate the tail, okay? And this is also crucial for the final error. So let me mention briefly the maybe this is the more technical part of the talk, but this is critical, I believe, because this is the largest uncertainty in the BMW results. Okay, and it's associated to the continuum limit extrapolation. So you start with the QCD and QED action. Here you have the Dirac operator, and you have to choose a discretization of the Dirac operator. Okay, so BMW uses the staggered quark discretization. Staggered quarks have the property of preserving chiral symmetry to a fairly good extent, but they break flavor symmetry. And the reason is that they are mixing spinor and space-time indices. So this breaking of flavor symmetry implies that instead of one single quark flavor, you have four of them. And in order to distinguish them from a physical flavor, they are called tastes, okay? So you have four tastes for each flavor of quark. This is a discretization effect. It should go away in the continuum limit, but it turns out to be a large discretization effect. And this is shown in this plot on the left. So in this plot on the left, you see the pion mass splitting associated to these taste breaking effects normalized by the physical value of the pion mass, okay? As a function of the lattice spacing. So what you see is that you have non-zero values and therefore that you have a taste splitting of the pions. And at the coarsest lattice spacing around 0.13 Fermi, this implies that you have 16 different pions because you have four tastes. And when you combine into a pion, you have 16 different pions. And the mass splitting between the lightest pion, which is at the physical point, 135 MeV, and the heaviest pion is of the order of 300 MeV. Okay, so you have a discretization effect, which is two times larger than the actual value of the mass that you're interested on. This discretization effect is reduced when you go to the finest lattice spacing. And here the difference between the two, the smallest and the largest mass is rather of the order of 40 MeV. Okay, so there's a large difference in cutoff effects when going to fine onto coarse lattice spacings in the pion spectrum. So the problem here is that the pions are the lightest particle in the spectrum. And as I said before, this A mu contribution is dominated by two pions. So if you change significantly your pi contribution, you are expecting to change significantly A mu, okay? And this is what you observe in the right-hand plot, right-hand side plot. So this is the light UD contribution to MU, the connected one, because there's also a disconnected diagram, as a function of the lattice spacing squared, okay? And the red triangles are the raw data that they obtain for MU. And as you can see, there are large discretization effects. The point here corresponds to the continuum limit. And the problem is not really that the discretization effects are large, but the problem is rather that they are nonlinear. Okay, so the dependence on A squared is nonlinear. So BMW decides not to try a continuum extrapolation of these points, but rather to introduce a model to correct for these phase breaking effects. So they use a model, the rho pion gamma model. So this is a Lagrangian model depending on these fields, which have external input through five parameters. So three of these parameters receive physical information from the rho mass, rho width, and the rho decay constant. And m pi is a free parameter of the model. Okay, so within this model, you can compute the pion vacuum polarization and therefore a mu from the model. Okay, and you can also staggerize the model, so that is transform this model into a staggered quark model by replacing this pion vacuum polarization by the vacuum polarization averaged over the various states. Okay, and what they do is that they take their measurements of a mu, so these triangles, and they add the continuum rho model and they subtract the staggered rho model in such a way that in the continuum this goes away. Okay, and through this procedure they model the effects of this state breaking, and this brings these points into these sets of points where the various lines depend on where you decide to use the model. So in this curve here, you could start applying the model from here to the right or from 0.4 to the right. Okay, so depending on where you use the model, you have a different continuum limit extrapolation. And once they have corrected, they perform the continuum limit extrapolation. And this histogram here is a way to illustrate the systematic effect associated to this continuum limit extrapolation. In this plot, if you would put the dispersive approach result, it will sit at around 625. So at the end of this tail of the histogram. Okay, so this is the size of the discrepancy between BMW and the dispersive approach. So as I said, you also need to include QED corrections. So this can be done by rewriting the Lagrangian of QCD plus QED as an isosymmetric piece plus as isospin breaking corrections, and by noting that the isospin correction parameters are small. Delta M is the difference between the down and the up quark, that in units of lambda QCD is a small parameter. The electromagnetic coupling is a small quantity. So you can tailor expand your observables in these two parameters and therefore compute the electromagnetic corrections at order alpha and at order delta M through computing the derivatives of your observable with respect to E and delta M, okay, by a tailor expansion. And this leads to the final results from the BMW collaboration. So this is a remarkable computation in the sense that they have managed to put small errors in all the pieces that contribute to the final error. The final result is this one. So it has a 2.3 statistical error and a 5.0 systematic error. So it's systematics dominated. These errors here are basically coming from the light connected piece, okay? The other pieces have importance, they have to be computed, but most of the error is coming from this piece. Okay, the second source of error are finite volume effects, and this is expected because, as I said, this is quantities dominated by pi contributions, and disconnected contributions also have a large contribution. They observe this is prescription dependent, so it depends on how they have separated isospin symmetric from isospin breaking, but they observe that the sum of the isospin breaking contributions associated to mass difference in the up down and QED effects basically cancel. You can see this from the fact that these two diagrams give roughly 1.5 contribution, but these two also give roughly the same contribution with a relative sign. So there are huge cancellations in between these contributions. which implied that you have to be very careful in computing each of them in order to really observe this cancellation. Okay, so this is a comparison with respect to the dispersive approach result. Okay, it's a 2.1 sigma difference, and it's also a 2.1% difference in the sense that the ratio is 2.1%. Okay, so this leads to the comparison that I showed at the beginning. Okay, so this white paper result is coming from this result, and this BMW result is coming from the BMW. Okay, so in order to assess what is the origin of this discrepancy, let me put this into context with respect to other studies in the lattice. Okay, so this is the status of the comparison between lattice determinations of AMU. So there are other six groups doing these computations in addition to BMW, and as you can see, the errors are much larger. Okay. The target is that in the time frame of maybe 2 years, there will be various of these lattice groups with similar uncertainties with respect to BMW. Look, this is the result from BMW in 2017. So this is the progress they did in these 3 years. So one expects that the other groups will be able to reach a similar reduction in the coming years. There is a lot of progress in this field to expect. So another thing one can do is a direct comparison. Try to aim at the direct comparison between the dispersive approach and lattice QCD in other quantities. So it turns out that it is very difficult to go from a space-like description of the quantity that enters in AMU, so the vacuum polarization function, into the time-like description, because it would basically imply that you will be able to reconstruct all these resonance from smooth curves. But going the other way around is possible. And you can write down, for instance, the basic quantity that enters in the integral of the lattice computation, this C of t, in terms of the R ratio data. Okay? So basically, you can use the R ratio data to compute C of t, which is the quantity that is used on the lattice. So going from the right to the left is feasible, and it's an interesting source of comparisons. Okay? So in this integral that appears on the lattice computation, you can add a weight function W, which allows you to restrict yourself to particular values of T in the integral. Okay, so instead of integrating with one value over all the T values, you decide to remove contributions from short distances and remove contributions from large distances by introducing this weight W. Okay. This maps into a similar weight in the variable square root of s used in the dispersive approach. So for instance, this window, which highlights regions between 0.4 and 1 GeV, Fermi in Euclidean time, corresponds to this weight here in square root of s, which suppresses small values of s and very large values of square root of s. Okay. And you can therefore compute this AMU window, okay, and compare between lattice groups and with respect to the R ratio. And this is the continuum limit extrapolation of this AMU window from BMW. So this is the result from BMW. This is another lattice result from the RBC UK QCD collaboration using a different discretization of the Dirac operator. And this is the R ratio result, okay? This shows the same quantity with more lattice inputs. So one observation with respect to the full AMU is that by doing this cut through a window, you remove the large distance contribution, which is very difficult for the lattice. And that implies that in this AMU window, the other lattice groups have smaller errors. Okay, so this is a very interesting probe to compare lattice results. And what you observe is that the BMW is basically very much consistent with all these sets of points. All of these first 5 points, all come from staggered quark simulations. Okay, so for the Dirac operator was using staggered quarks. These 3 points here instead use another regularization, domain wall fermions for RBC and Wilson-like fermions for ETMC and for MIMES. Okay. So although this is not totally settled, there are some hints that there might be some differences in the lattice results depending on the regularization that is being used for the fermion action. Okay. With respect to the 2.1 sigma that is shown as a discrepancy for A mu between BMW and the air ratio, when you look at these window quantities, the discrepancy goes up to 3.7. Okay. So this is saying something about a region of Q squared, which would be more problematic for the comparison. Okay. So from electroweak precision tests, one excludes that it is possible to change the cross section of E plus E minus at large energies, but instead changes at small energies are possible. And this is shown by this plot here. You observe that the prediction from the electroweak precision test deviates from the measurement of the Higgs mass if you go to deviations in the cross section above 1 GeV. But that implies, if you allow for changes in the cross section below 1 GeV, that implies that you will have substantial changes in the cross section. And this is shown in this plot. So in order to be able to match the dispersion relation result to the BMW result, one would need, for instance, at 1 GeV for the upper bound of the integral, roughly a 3% change in the cross section, which is much larger than the uncertainty on the measurement of the cross section. So one would need large change in the cross section. So as I said, one can also use lattice QCD to compute the running of the QED coupling. And this is shown in this plot. And it's comparing the lattice result from the Mainz group to the dispersive approach by KNT and by Jaeger-Lehner. And although the precision is still not very high, it is suggesting that in the region between 0 and 1 GeV squared, deviations of that order of few percent are possible, okay? This is another comparison between the lattice results and the dispersion relation in the pi plus pi minus channel, more precisely in the region below 1 GeV. So these are the experimental inputs. You see again the tension between Chloe and Babar between these two points. This is a global fit using also constraints coming from the time-like pine form factor. And this is the BMW result in which one has to subtract the contribution from higher energies than 1 GeV in order to be able to put it in this plot, okay? So this is the status of this comparison. There is a 2.1 sigma difference between BMW and the white paper. It corresponds also to a 2.1% change. By looking at these windows that I mentioned, this difference goes to 3.7 sigma. If you look at the ratio of the QED coupling or the hadronic contributions to it, one observes a similar 3.7 sigma between BMW and R ratio at small Q squareds, so at 1 GeV squared. And if one goes to larger Q squared, so the difference between 1 GeV and 10 GeV, the tension disappears, okay? So this is telling us that most of the difference is coming from the low energy region. So what are the prospects? One expects new experimental data, new analysis of that experimental data for the data-driven dispersive approach. So various experiments are collecting or analyzing data. On the lattice, there is a significant effort from various groups in order to reduce the uncertainties. I think it's very important to have results from various discretizations and to have a good control of these cancellations that I mentioned in the isospin breaking corrections. One expects also a very close collaboration between the data-driven approach, the sum of the R ratio data and the lattice in order to identify specific channels and regions of Q square where a discrepancy can be residing. Another important prospect for the future is the fact that there is a proposed experiment called Muon E, which aims at extracting the running of the QED coupling from space-like region using mu E elastic scattering, okay? So this will really be very important, I believe, because this will allow a direct comparison in the sense that both are space-like with respect to the lattice, in a region where the lattice cannot have very high accuracy. Okay, so this will complement in a way the lattice results, and we probably should shed some light in this discrepancy. So I'm running out of time, so I don't really have time to discuss the other contributions. I discussed the most important one. So the Fermilab experiment is collecting data. The round one result they published 2 months ago is coming only from 6% of their data. They have already collected more than 10 times that. They plan to publish by summer next year a new result with half of the present accuracy. Okay, and their target is to reduce by a factor of 4 overall in by the end of the experiment and reach this 1.5 10 to the minus 10 accuracy. There is another experiment which involves cold muons. It's basically a tabletop experiment which has completely different technology with respect to Fermilab and aims at the precision similar to the current precision that will be a fantastic cross-check of the experimental side. Most of the work, of course, currently will be concentrating in consolidating the standard model of the standard model value of the muon G minus 2. As I said, the QED and the electroweak precisions are safely under control given the current uncertainties. The hadronic light by light is at the border, and thinking of this 1.5 error from the experimental side, one probably desires a reduction by a factor of 2 with respect to the current value. And most of the work, of course, will be concentrated in understanding this tension in the hadronic vacuum polarization side. As I said, one expects interplay between dispersive approach and lattice. The muon E experiment will give very important clarification to this current situation. And probably one expects wishes a reduction by a factor of 3 to 4 in the uncertainty in this hadronic vacuum polarization. 3 if the standard model consolidates in the white paper side, and roughly and rather 4 if it consolidates towards the BMW side. So thanks very much.
Thank you, Gregorio. So I already see a question by Álvaro.
Yes.
Hi. I have a comment and a question. I'll start with a question. Maybe you have answered it and I didn't notice. Suppose in the dispersive approach, since the two main experiments disagree, you use one of them only or the other one of them only. What is the result of trying to do that? Maybe you showed it, yes?
I showed it, but I didn't comment. You're totally right. So this is the low energy contribution, so below 1 GeV. Okay, so it's the most important part. This is the global fit that I mentioned using constraints from the time-like pion form factor. And it's also interesting to note that if you use the time-like pion form factor, you can use data for the pion form factor in order to also constrain that fit. So this is this input from NA7, okay? What you're mentioning is probably these 2 points here. So these are the results if you exclude Chloe or if you exclude Babar, okay? So
is one of the results significantly closer to the observation?
No. The change is not sufficiently large in order to merge the gap between theory and experiment. But this is the BMW result, which is midway between the white paper and the experiment, and it's sitting here. Okay, so yeah, the Babar result is closer to the BMW result
in this. Okay, and my comment is the following: if the two experiments disagree to about three sigma, as you say, and that means two things. It means that the experiment is very difficult. And it means that at least one of them is wrong, maybe two. And the solution taken by the particle data group in cases when there is a significant discrepancy is to do something which is neither based on physics nor on mathematics. It's just a diplomatic decision. they have two experiments that disagree, and then they say the result is that with this error. And that's very worrisome.
Yes, but this hasn't been done in that way in the white paper. So in the white paper, the PDG prescription was not used. What was used instead is the two groups that did the dispersive integral together with other groups, in particular, Colangelo, Richter, Stoffer, that have pushed in the direction of putting additional constraints through this unitarity, analyticity coming from the time-like point form factor. So they sit together. So this was really a collective effort. And channel by channel, they analyzed the discrepancy between the two groups, and they selected for each of the channel the largest deviation and the largest systematic error. So that's one thing. And on top of that, for this discrepancy between Babar and Chloe, what they did is precisely what is shown here. So they took the result excluding Chloe, excluding Babar, and they took half of the dispersion between the two as a systematic error. And this is basically the largest contribution to the error. So it's not a PDG, it's really something analyzed specifically for this case that was done.
Okay, thank you very much. So maybe the most interesting thing is the discrepancy between the lattice and the dispersive result. That's even more interesting than the disagreement with experiment.
Yes, I agree on that. There is really something to understand. I think these window quantities are very interesting in the sense that these are not physically motivated, but these are cooked quantities in order to highlight regions of Q squared. And in particular, you can select your windows in regions where you have good control of your computation. So this would be benchmark. And you can also take windows in regions which are more challenging. And this window I showed here is one when one expects good control, because one has cut the small distance and large distance, which are the most difficult paths for the lattice. And one observes that in this region of Q squared associated to this window, the discrepancy between BMW and the error ratio actually increases. So it goes to 3.7 sigma. So this is something to be understood.
Yep, thanks very much.
Those were mainly my questions. Also, there is a question in the chat. I'm going to read it.
Okay, I cannot see it.
Do you know if there are theoretical calculations using other non-perturbative methods like holographic models of hadrons?
I don't know, but the two methods that are being used, that is the dispersive approach and lattice QCD, are first principle methods. So I think this is the logic here, is to avoid as much as possible model dependence in the prediction of a standard model.
So Sven has his hand up also. Sven?
Yeah, thanks for this interesting talk. I hope you, well, maybe I missed it, the usual disclaimer. The BMW result from the first publication more than a year ago until the final publication moved by somewhat more than one sigma away from the experimental result. Do you know what happened there or what caused this change?
Yes, so the BMW result was analyzed by the community. Okay, so there has been, in the context of this theory initiative, there has been a series of workshops. And the BMW result, when it appeared as a preprint, has been scrutinized by various lattice groups, and the BMW collaboration received various suggestions on their computations, and they have actually implemented those. And this is the origin of those changes. So I'm aware of two contributions to this. The first one is associated to the scale setting. So the determination of the lattice spacing in Fermi. So they changed in the main analysis the observable that was used in order to do the scale setting. So in the past, they were using two observables. And due to a problem in the continuum limits extrapolation of one of those. What I mean problem is more a challenge in controlling that continuum extrapolation. I'm talking about the float of serval called W0. They decided to do their main analysis without using W0 and using directly the omega baryon mass. Okay, so that is one piece of the origin of the change. And the second one is that they changed the preferred model to perform the continuum extrapolation. Okay, so in this complicated continuum extrapolation that I've shown, they have used various models in order to model these state breaking effects. They were using this Meyer-Lelouch, Lusher, Gonari, Sakurai model first, and then they switched to this resonance row model. So that is also part of the change. And probably there are other effects also. It's a one sigma effect, so this can very well happen.
Yeah, of course. I'm just curious now what's going on. Okay, thanks a lot.
Alberto Ramos has his hand up also.
Hi, Gregorio. Thank you very much for the talk. Coming back a bit to the window observables, this discrepancy, when it is increased, is in a window of distances where the difference between Chloe and Babar plays no role, if I look at this.
It's not totally true, but it's true that the window has not been selected to highlight the region where there is a discrepancy between Chloe and Babar. Okay. So the region between Chloe and the discrepancy between Chloe and Babar is between 0.6 and 0.9 GV squared. Okay. Yes. So basically in this region here.
Yes, exactly.
And the window highlights that region, but not as much.
Yeah, so it enhances the region. So it seems that there is something more than really the difference between Chloe and Babar.
That is correct. Okay, this depends on the accuracy, of course, of the comparison. The choice of this window was motivated because it is safer, it is better controlled than the one that would need in order to highlight the difference between Chloe and Babar. So if you want, that would come afterwards. Once one has consolidated lattice result in this window, one could shift to another window that highlights the difference between Chloe and Babar.
I understand. And another related question is with this plot that you have there down on the right of your slide. I mean, how many of these computations are really independent? I mean, for example, the first two is really the same computation with two different continuum extrapolations. It looks like there is some tension even between the lattice computations, but I think that if this is properly done, it looks like lattice is pointing towards a higher value than the dispersive approach, and there is quite some consistency in the lattice. So being concrete, there are two questions. First is the two works of Obing et al, okay? Mm-hmm. I think that these are really two different continuum extrapolations, so maybe it's better to put one point with a larger error.
Yeah.
There is also the two works of Mainz that maybe you know, because I have no idea there, what is the difference between them?
I can't comment on that. So the two points by Obin et al. Are precisely these two points here. Yeah. So one is coming from these two lattice spacings, final lattice spacing, and gives this value, and the other is taking three lattice spacing. So that is the two points that you saw. And I fully agree, therefore these are fully correlated results, they are not independent. The Mainz result comes from in this integral you have a function which is analytic f, but you are allowed to modify this function provided that you don't change the continuum limit. Okay, mm-hmm. So what Mainz is doing is that they're modifying in this function the muon mass appears. So Mainz is doing a modification of the kernel by multiplying the muon mass times the ratio of the decay constant of the pi on f pi measured over the experimental value, I mean the phenomenological value of f pi, okay, in such a way that in the physical point in the continuum this ratio is one, okay,
have less dependence on the scale with this.
And what they observe is by doing this rescaling, they reduce the dependence on the pion mass, so the chiral extrapolation is safer, and also discretization effects are reduced.
Okay, so this is the point that appears there now in your right plot there down.
So okay, if I come back, yeah, sorry. Yeah, so in this plot, it's the difference between these two.
And which one is the one that they claim to be safer?
I believe they are going the direction of using FPI rescaling as their preferred result.
Okay.
But this is just a guess. These are preliminary for the moment. So I agree with your global comment on correlations. These plots are intended for consistency check. This is not published anywhere. This is extracted from a workshop, okay? So these are ongoing checks between lattice groups. It is true that the three first points are correlated because they use the same set of gauge field configurations as FHM, okay? So there are actual correlations in the sense that the input data is the same. The observables are measured differently.
Thank you very much.
Thank you, Gregorio. So I don't see more questions, but I actually have one. I mean, you convinced me because I was aware of this tension between Chloe and Babar, and I was curious as how that tension was taken into account. So thanks to Alvaro's question, now I know. And indeed, it's a very conservative approach. So it does not seem to possible that is the bulk of the uncertainty. But still, since there is a three sigma tension between those two, and you mentioned the prospects of new measurements by other experiments taking data, do you know what is the timeline approximate for getting competitive?
Okay, so there are. You mean for the dispersive approach, right? This new experiment. So CMD3, so Novosibirsk, has already published some results that are mentioned in the white paper, but appeared after the analysis of the sum of the integral was performed. And the new results from here, which are direct scan experiments, are between Chloe and Babar. So given the current appearance, they don't resolve yet the issue. Babar is finished as experiment, so it's basically a new way to analyze the data that is being carried out. So I don't know the time scale, but I suppose a matter of maybe a month or a year. And Del2 is starting, so this would probably take a bit longer. But I don't have a definite answer. I mean, probably all these timelines are constrained by the publication of the new experimental result by Fermilab. So this, of course, is putting a lot of momentum in the various groups, the lattice and the dispersive approach.
So you also feel the pressure.
Yeah, I mean, one of the targets of this theory initiative is to update the standard model prediction previously of any new experimental results. So by the summer of next year, there will probably be an updated value of the standard model prediction.
Okay, great. So thanks a lot. It was really comprehensive and very clear. Thank you very much. So I can clap. The rest of the people can clap. Thank you, Gregorio.
Thank you.